Dear brothers and sisters of our Lord Jesus Christ, on this day the Church begins a holy season of prayerful and penitential reflection. Our attention is especially directed to the holy sufferings and death of our Lord Jesus Christ. From ancient times, the season of Lent has been kept as a time of special devotion, self-denial, and humble repentance, born of a faithful heart that dwells confidently on His Word and draws from it life and hope. Let us pray that our dear Father in heaven, for the sake of His beloved Son and in the power of His Holy Spirit, might richly bless this Lenten tide for us, so that we may come to Easter with glad hearts and keep the feast in sincerity and truth. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. And You forgave the iniquity of my sin. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor sinner, confess to You all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, You will not despise.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to Your steadfast love. According to Your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin.
Transgressions, and my sin is ever before me.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from Your presence, and take not Your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of Your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, You despise nothing You have made, and forgive the sins of all who are penitent. Create in us new and contrite hearts, that lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, we may receive from You full pardon and forgiveness. Through Jesus Christ, Your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with You and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. On this Ash Wednesday, our Old Testament lesson is from the prophet Joel, chapter 2. Yet even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and he relents over disaster. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, consecrate a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, consecrate the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, even nursing infants. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep and say, spare your people, O Lord, and make not your heritage a reproach, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? Then the Lord became jealous for his land and had pity on his people. The Lord answered and said to his people, behold, I am sending to you grain, wine, and oil, and you will be satisfied, and I will no more make you a reproach among the nations. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. O come, let us fix our eyes on Jesus. Who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame. Our epistle lesson is from 2 Corinthians chapters 5 and 6. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Working together with him, then, we appeal to you not to receive the grace of God in vain. For he says, in a favorable time I listened to you, and in a day of salvation I have helped you. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. We put no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, by great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, the Holy Spirit, genuine love, by truthful speech and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, through honor and dishonor, through slander and praise. We are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold we live, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing yet possessing everything. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 18th chapter. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, whom do you seek? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus said to them, I am he. Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "Of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given to me?" This is the gospel of the Lord. I believe in one God.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. This Lenten season, we're going to walk through the passion of Jesus as recorded in the Gospel of John. I'm going to be using basic outlines and theme ideas for each week from Pastor Brian Wolfmuller, as published by him in Concordia Pulpit Resources. However, I will be writing the sermons myself. So that's where we are going this midweek, these midweek Lenten services, through the passion of Jesus from the Gospel of John. We begin today with the arrest of Jesus. Tonight we are with Jesus in the garden. The passion of Jesus, by the way, notice, it begins and ends in gardens. Different gardens, but gardens nonetheless. I think there's an interesting parallel there with how the passion of Jesus starts and ends with the history of mankind, which also begins and will end in gardens. Something to think about. Jesus had just prior to this, in our gospel lesson, finished teaching his disciples for the last time. He washed their feet as an example of serving one another. He prayed for them. Most importantly, he instituted the Lord's Supper and fed them his body and blood for the forgiveness of their sins. And when all this was finished, they leave the upper room. They go east out of Jerusalem, down through the Kidron Valley, and into Gethsemane, a garden. So it begins. His agony begins. And Jesus asks his disciples to pray with him, but they sleep. His stress is so great that he sweats blood, and yet they sleep three times, and they fall asleep. Then comes Judas. He had left early from the upper room in order to go and arrange the betrayal. He now comes with soldiers and officers and officials from the Sanhedrin. They don't know who Jesus is or necessarily recognize him, but Judas does. So as they approach, Jesus approaches them and he asks, "Whom do you seek?" They answer, "Jesus of Nazareth." Now Jesus' answer in our translation, which is what we've got printed there from the ESV, I will tell you it's a poor translation, which is why the actions of these guards seems puzzling to us. Those of you who have been in my Bible study on John, you've heard this already, and you know what I will be talking about. You see, throughout the Gospel of John, there are many places where Jesus says, "I am the door," or "I am the good shepherd," or "I am the way, the truth, and the life." He's not merely saying that he is something. Rather, in all of these cases, he is actually using a very unusual phrase in the Greek. He says, "ego I me." That's a strange grammar to a Greek speaker. But the reason Jesus uses that, "ego I me," is because it's a direct translation of a Hebrew word, Yahweh. What Jesus is actually saying here is the name of God himself from the Old Testament, Yahweh, translated into Greek. He is saying, "I am." That's what he says here in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he's about to say it twice. And two very different things happen. This is amazing. Watch what happens with Jesus here in the garden. So the soldiers come to him at first, and he asks, "Whom do you seek?" And they answer, "Jesus of Nazareth." And Jesus says, are you ready? "I am." With that word, Jesus reveals the truth of who he is. And he demonstrates the power of his divine majesty. That word, that phrase, which they understand, the weight and nature of that word and how it is the translation and reflects God's holy name from the Old Testament.
That takes them by such surprise that the soldiers drew back and fell to the ground. It's like they're hit by a tornado. Lanterns drop, swords and spears fall to the ground, and the men, out of instinct, they fall to the ground out of respect for that name, the name of their holy God. This is a sign. One little word can fell them. They fall to the ground in obedience. But then, after just a mere moment, they collect themselves, they stand up, they dust themselves off, pick up their lanterns and their torches and their spears. So Jesus asks them again, a second time, "Whom do you seek?" Now, perhaps this time they're a little bit more hesitant. They're not quite sure. Perhaps they look at each other, kind of wondering if they should answer the same. They grit their teeth, they grasp their swords, they plant their feet and get ready. Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus says again, "I told you, I am." This time, nothing happens. They're ready. They're ready to resist the power of God's name. No one falls over. No one teeters. They stand there. The first "I am" sent them flying and bowing to the ground. The second "I am" doesn't move them at all. The first "I am" shows that Jesus is God in the flesh. It's commanding, it's compelling this band of guards. The second "I am" shows that Jesus is not using his power to protect and save himself. He refrains from that commanding power. The first "I am" demonstrates that Jesus could avoid the cross if he chose to, through the power of his voice, through his commanding authority. The second "I am" shows that he will refrain from that, and rather he will willingly and quietly be led like a sheep to be slaughtered. The first "I am" is a miracle of God's power, a demonstration of God's power. The second "I am" is a miracle of Christ's weakness, his willing weakness. And that is the greater miracle, the greater wonder, the greater gift, that the creator of the universe, the one who spoke and sun, moon, and stars popped into existence, that creator is here in the garden, and he speaks, and the band of soldiers is repelled and fall down. That's no surprise. That's what God should be like. That is the power and presence of our holy God. But then the second time, he speaks again the second time, and nothing happens. No commanding word of presence. The soldiers are still standing, resisting, opposing God himself. And so they approach Jesus. Nothing happens. No running away. They touch him. Nothing happens. No fighting back. They grab him and bind him. Nothing happens. No struggle on the part of Jesus. They lead him away to interrogation, accusation, conviction, and then crucifixion. Nothing happens to them. No shaft of fire shooting down from heaven to strike them. Son of God refuses to use his power. He refrains from calling down those legions of angels to his aid. Behold, the miracle of weakness of God. Behold the humility of Christ to willingly set aside his power. Behold the suffering of God himself, of Jesus, for sinners. Sinners like you and me. This is why Jesus came. This is why Jesus took on our flesh and blood, so that rather than you, there's another back to whip, another brow to crown, other hands and feet to pierce, someone else's blood to spill. This is why Jesus came, to carry your sin and your sorrow for you and to be your salvation. When Jesus was arrested, he showed his great love for you and me. As the great I am, not in power and a commanding voice, but rather in weakness and willing submission. So, my dear fellow saints, I ask you on this Ash Wednesday, whom do you seek? And our answer is Jesus of Nazareth. And he says to you, I am. Jesus, are you a friend of sinners? I am. Jesus, are you our light and our hope and our salvation and our redemption? I am. And then we ask, Jesus, are you there for me? He says, I am. And in that response, Jesus, right there on the cross, embraces weakness for you and for me in order to earn for you the forgiveness of sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and your minds in the one true faith in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated as we continue with our offering and our offertory. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we pray for your blessing upon us now and throughout this Lenten season and beyond. Help us to have repentant hearts, to know of the great willingness of weakness that you took on for our sake. Grant us the forgiveness that can only be earned through the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. Strengthen us all in faith, and point us all to the glory of Easter that awaits for us in the eternal life with you. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. We continue with the Lord's Supper.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who overcame the assaults of the devil and gave his life as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, We laud and magnify your glorious name evermore, praising you and singing. Our forever and ever. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Now may this true body and true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you and keep you steadfast in the one true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace with great joy. Amen. Thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy forever.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.